give me more time.
Okay.
Yeah.
You turn this off or this one? One of them. Shall we start? We'll start by chanting Om and a few other shlokas, prayers. You can repeat after me. Let us start with Om.
Volume isn't there, Guruji.
Are you able to hear me now? I think I have to speak loudly. Is it okay now?
Yes.
Yes, we can hear you, Krishnaji.
Okay, I think Prasad Pallavi?
No.
I think it's something at your end then, because others are able to hear me. Do you want to join again? Just disconnect and try connecting again.
Now it is okay.
Okay, so we'll start. We'll start by chanting Om. Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu,
Guru Vishnu,
Guru Devo,
Guru Devo,
Maheshwaraha,
Maheshwara, Guru Sakshat,
Parabrahma,
Parabrahma, Tasmai Shri,
Gurave Namaha,
Gurave Namaha,
Shruti Smriti,
Shruti Smriti
Purananam
Purananam
Alayam
Alayam
Arunalayam
Arunalayam
Namami
Namami
Bhagavat Padam
Bhagavat Padam
Shankaram
Shankaram
Loka Shankaram
Loka Shankaram
Sadashiva
Sadashiva
Samarambhat
Shankaracharya
Madhyamam
Asmadacharya Paryantam
De Guru Paramparam
Paramparam.
My pranams to all. Slowly open your eyes. So let us continue our contemplation on the teachings of Mandukya Upanishad. There are some people who have missed session one. I'll quickly do a recap and we'll get into the second shloka. We covered the Shanti Mantra. So all the Upanishads have a Shanti Mantra. meaning it's setting the goal before you actually get into the discussion. What are we trying to achieve? So what are we trying to achieve? The focus is very clear. Everybody's purpose in everything, to do anything. I want to become wealthy. I want to become famous. I want to get married. I don't want to get married. I want to get divorced. I want to have children. I don't want children. Whatever, any decision or any movement in our life, the purpose is very clear. I want happiness and I don't want suffering. Okay, so our movement is towards happiness, away from pain, right? For that happiness, you have some conditions. You could say, I want happiness, but I can't know or experience happiness directly. I will put some condition in between. And that condition is usually an object. When I say object, object includes experience, event, and sensation. Yeah, I want this so that I become happy. The question is there a way I can directly access this happiness? And it is not, I'm not at the mercy of it happening to me occasionally. Otherwise, it happens to me occasionally. I'm at the mercy of life, that whenever it, I have to wait for it. So is there a way that I can be happy and peaceful unconditionally, infinitely, without any dependency on anything external or dependency on anything that I don't have control of? And clearly, I don't have control of a lot of things, including my own body and mind. I don't know what kind of thoughts my mind will throw up tomorrow, what state my body will be in, what state my job will be in, what state my relationship will be in. Everything is very uncertain. So I'm basically trying to navigate very cautiously. Can I be more relaxed and still have everything? So this is the focus. The focus is happiness infinitely, unconditioned, peace, and no suffering. Anybody has any other focus? Vivek, any other focus? Any other focus? I'd like to have these things, but still I would like to have some money. So this focus, achievement or result or experience is what, not exactly this, a notion of this is what our ancestors called as mukti or enlightenment. So this is what we know from stories and serials and movies of somebody attain enlightenment. Simply means what? They've gone beyond the ordinary experience where they're no longer working for happiness. It has become their natural state and something that they can never lose. It's become a permanent experience and they can no longer suffer. And also they have become free from cycle of birth and death and all those things. We'll explore that. So the Shanti Mantra is about a prayer for may everybody attain this, because that's what human birth is about. Human birth is about reaching your full potential. The seed has to become the tree. It has to completely unleash its full potential. And your fullest potential is becoming the supreme reality, or realizing that you are the supreme reality. So like I said in the last session, the Upanishads are not here to tell you that you can become supreme reality. Okay, so you do these things, study these things, practice these things, then one day you'll become supreme reality. No, you are already the supreme reality, confusing yourself to be something else. So it's a correction of an error that's happening in your thinking. Right? And that is why it's called Upanishad. Upanishad means to have a dialogue with somebody. And in the case of the Upanishad, with a guru, with a master, to have a dialogue that removes my, that corrects my thinking, that removes my error. That's all. Is what is Upanishad clear? Upanishad is Upanishad. Upa means higher. Higher means not physically higher. The higher refers to higher in consciousness. So everybody wants to go to the higher place, mountain. Right? In this tradition of spirituality, the mountains are given a special place. There's something about the mountain. If you go there, you'll get some extraordinary experience. It's not actually the physical mountain, but which popularly in the spiritual tradition is known as Himalayas. It is the Himalayan experience of a human being, the peak of human experience. And the peak of human experience is to go beyond all experiences. Because every experience, you lose it after some time. And it's dependent on some conditions. The body has to be in a certain way. Your peace is always conditioned. For your peace, everybody should be quiet at home. Okay? Every seat should be comfortable. Your plate should be full. Stomach should be full. You should not have any craving. So many conditions, right? The Himalayan peak experiences, unconditionally, you are in your natural, tranquil state. Yeah? So that is the focus. And the Upanishad is higher, the higher consciousness of somebody who is sitting at that peak, not somebody physically sitting on the top of the mountain, but somebody internally has reached that consciousness, Nishad, to sit near that person and to have a dialogue and to ask questions and to inquire into how one human being has attained something which obviously by our experience and knowledge is not impossible for me or anybody else. Like if one other human being gets something, wealth or some sort of knowledge, if I follow the same steps, or if I also go in that direction and put effort, I also should be able to get it. Or if I have some limitation, maybe there's a person who has won Olympics. Okay, to win an Olympic medal, you have to do some extreme preparation. Now, I cannot aspire for that because, let's say, I am handicapped. But I know intuitively that somebody else who has certain prerequisites can also get that. That is the whole point of dialogue, where somebody has got it. Somebody who is in my time period, in front of me, has attained peace. Let me also get that. And unlike some external achievement, this is more closer to you. It doesn't require, it's not dependent on any attribute, physical or mental. That is the importance of an Upanishad. Why Upanishad? Is to have a dialogue. If you value that, okay, somebody has something which is which you feel is valuable, let me also get that. If you feel is valuable. Okay, so that's what we sort of looked at in the last session. What is Upanishad? What is the Mandukya Upanishad? The Mandukya Upanishad is the shortest Upanishad. It has only 12 shlokas, and the 12 shlokas talk directly about how you are the Supreme Reality. It breaks it down step by step. Step 1, step 2, step 3, it breaks it down and takes you to the Supreme Reality. That is the Mandukya Upanishad. And last class I told you, Mandukya Upanishad, background about the Mandukya Upanishad, some significance and glory about the Mandukya Upanishad. You can again refer to that video of that session to understand the glories of Mandukya Upanishad. Today we'll take up, we also covered the first shloka of Mandukya Upanishad, which talks about Omkara. The entire Mandukya Upanishad is about Om. Nothing else. Only Om. And Om has three sounds. A, Akara, A, U, Ukara, and Ma, Makara. A, U, Ma. And the A, U, Ma is what makes the entire creation. What I initially we spoke about, me, there is a me, there is a world, and there is something beyond. all these three are nothing but omkara. What I call as me, what I see as word, and whatever is operating the word, the Lord, God, or any other consciousness, that this and me are all omkara, and how they are omkara is elaborated in the shlokas of the Mandukya Upanishad. And Mandukya Upanishad, one of the speciality of Mandukya Upanishad is it directly illumines the truth by taking your attention to the truth in your own experience of waking, dreaming, and deep sleep. So waking, dreaming, and deep sleep are three states all of us go through, and all human beings go through. That's a very common experience for all human beings: waking, dreaming, and deep sleep. It helps you shift the attention from the waking, the truth in the waking, the truth in the dreaming, and the truth in the deep sleep by inquiring into them. That is the beauty of the Mandukya Upanishad. And that's why it's known as the simplest, the shortest, the shortcut movement. If anybody wants enlightenment, mukti, infinite happiness and peace, doesn't want to do anything, doesn't want to put effort, it has to come and sit in my lap. Mandukya Upanishad is the way. And that's the beauty of creation. Whatever you seek, you'll get. Okay, this was the quick recap on what we covered in the first session. Today, like I said, we'll go into the second shloka of the Mandukya Upanishad. Any doubts so far? Lakshmi? No doubts. Okay. So let us chant the second shloka and then contemplate on the second shloka. Sarvam hetad brahma ayam atma brahma soyam atma chatushpa. Again, sarvam hetad brahma ayam atma brahma soyam atma chatushpa. So sarvam hetad brahma. First thing to understand is when they use the word brahma here, we have heard of the Trinity, the Holy Trinity: Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva. They are not referring to the Chaturmukha Brahma. Whenever the Upanishads and the Upanishads are part of the system called Vedanta, they're the end part of the Vedas. They're the direct inquiry into the truth. Whenever the Upanishads, the masters, Bhagavad Gita, or any text in Vedanta uses the word Brahma, never confuse it with Chaturmukha Brahma, the four-faced creator. It refers to Brahman, supreme reality, supreme consciousness. What that is, we'll see. But don't have a mental image. The mind, usually when you say apple, it has a mental image of apple. When you say the word Brahma, it has a mental image of some person with certain characteristics. It is the formless reality, Brahman. So sarvam hetad brahma, everything that you see, hetad, whatever is visible, is that invisible, is the supreme reality. And everything includes you also. Okay, sarvam hetad brahma, ayam atma brahma. So ayam atma brahma, I, myself, is Brahman. And soyam atma chatushpa. And this Brahman has four quadrants, four aspects. This is the literal translation and meaning of the shloka that we just chanted. Sarvam hetad brahma, everything is Brahman, everything is the supreme reality. Ayam atma brahma, I am Brahman. And the Brahman has four quadrants. Now the only movement or discussion is about, all these things are contradictory to my experience. Sarvam hetad brahma is not my experience. It's my knowledge. Okay, people have heard, where is God? God is everywhere. Okay, or where is God? There is no God. there is something that the Upanishad is saying is very contrary to my experience. I am not experiencing Sarvadheta Brahma. Everything is Brahma. No, everything is not Brahma. Everything is five elements: earth, water, air, space, and fire. Everything is made of five elements, right? That is my experience. How is it Brahma? And I am Brahma. I am not Brahma, because I am clearly me, whatever I call me as. And so am Atma Chatuspa. I won't even get into that, because none of the first two are not relevant to me. So there is, the Upanishad is making a statement: Sarvam Etat Brahma, I am Atma Brahma, so am Atma Chatuspa, is completely in contradiction to my experience. So the Upanishad is about removing that, resolving that conflict. That's all. And that conflict is in, not in experience, the conflict in is in perception of the experience. The experience itself is not causing the problem. Your interpretation of the experience is causing the problem. Okay? Same way, all the foundation of all relationship problems. What that person said is not the problem. How you interpreted it is the problem. Same thing is happening with spiritual texts also. What Jesus said is not the problem. Love thy neighbor is not the problem. How people interpreted it becomes the problem. Okay? Krishna said, go to war, is not a problem. How it got interpreted becomes a problem. So I'm seeing, I'm having an experience, it's not a problem. It's an experience, is an input to my senses. It's not a problem. How my mind interprets it is a problem. So let's take the case of Sarvam Hetat Brahma. Everything is Brahman is a statement. Now let's say you're in Paris. Okay, you're sitting, there's a, so everybody, whoever is in Dublin, you can imagine you're in Paris. Are you all able to hear me? Okay, let's say you're in, we're now first going, touching upon the Sarvam Hetat Brahma. Did you all understand what is the premise? We are trying to, there's a statement made by the enlightened being, the Rishi in the Upanishad, and there is my experience, and both of them, there is no correlation or connection possible. They're very far from each other. And they're very far from each other, not because of the experience, but because of the interpretation of the experience that we are having. And the Upanishad is about resolving that. Upanishad is not about giving you some other experience. It's not at all about giving you experiences. It's about correcting the perception so that the same experience, you start seeing the reality in that. So in that context, let's go to Paris. You're sitting in Paris. You're sitting in front of the Eiffel Tower. You can see the Eiffel Tower. I can see the Elita building there. That is the Eiffel Tower. You're sitting at a very beautiful cafe, holding a warm cup of coffee or tea, whatever you like. And you're enjoying the beauty. And across, on the other table, there is some very handsome man or a beautiful girl, and they come and sit at your table. You have a conversation, then you get married, okay, and then you start having a fight, and in the fight, the spouse that you're married to, they throw something at you, and you wake up and you realize all that was a dream. Okay, everything was a dream. Now, when you saw the Eiffel Tower in the dream, what was the Eiffel Tower? Was it really an Eiffel Tower? In the dream it was real, but what was it made up of? Can I say, is it safe for me to say, the person was sleeping, Lakshmi sleeping, the Lakshmi's consciousness became Eiffel Tower? Right, took the form of Eiffel Tower. Lakshmi's consciousness became another Lakshmi, another body. Lakshmi's consciousness became the coffee. Lakshmi's consciousness became the boy. Lakshmi's consciousness was everything. Your own consciousness, your own mind, took the form of every object, and you had many experiences. Is that right? So it's safe to say, Sarvam Hetat, waking Lakshmi, is it safe for me to say whatever was perceived in the dream is nothing but the waking Vivek, waking Surekha? Correct, Bina? Whatever you experienced, sensations, mental, psychological, and physical, me, world, and the forces. There was a gravity in Paris. You were not flying in Paris. There was a gravity also in Paris. That gravity also was your consciousness. So everything in your experience was you in the dream. And when you were experiencing the dream, was it real? Did you say, no, you're a dream girl, I won't talk to you. You're a dream guy, I won't talk to you. You're a dream coffee, I won't drink. When the coffee is presented to you in the dream, you experience it as if it's real. There is no doubt that it's a dream coffee, right? Everything in the dream that I perceived is my own consciousness. And I say my own, it's the person who is sleeping. And when I wake up, all that disappears. And what is not projected, me, remains. In the same way, whatever you see in the waking is also your own consciousness. Is Brahman. And what that consciousness is Brahman. And don't think Brahman means something infinite. Brahman, Sarvam Hetat Brahma means Sarvam Hetat. Brahman is I. The I in you is Brahman. I became Eiffel Tower in dream. I became coffee. I became the body. I became other person. I became experiences. In the same way, in the waking, that I, the supreme reality, Brahman, becomes everything that you perceive. It's not. It's exactly the same as the dream. There is only reality is Brahman, I. And I becomes everything. Sarvam Hetat Brahma. Whatever you perceive is only I. But now you are not able to say that confidently because what you think as I, what you know of yourself or I is objective. I am body, so I cannot be table. Correct? I am this, so I cannot be that. You understand? I am one object, so I cannot be another object. Object cannot become another object. Or object cannot know another object. So if I am object, there is no way I can be everything, every object. If I am not object, can I be everything? That's exactly what happens in dream. In dream, you let go of the object called body. That's what slipping into sleep means. You're completely slipping into a consciousness where you're no body. You're letting go of the waking body. And that is why you're able to project a world. And your I is able to become so many other things and create another world, a dream world. If you are not able to let go of the waking body, can the I project a dream? Can the I become something else? Because I is an object. So the I can't become a world. You understand? Sarvam Hetat Brahma. And I am Atma Brahma. So our problem is not the world. The world, what is the world? Our main problem is what am I? If I resolve what am I, what is the other will be figured out. And that's why the Upanishad continues to say, I am Atma Brahma, I am Brahman. Okay, and the I am Atma Brahma is one of the Mahavakyas. There are five Mahavakyas. Mahavakya means the greatest statements of realization. And one of the Mahavakya is, I am Atma Brahma. There is I am Atma Brahma, Sarvam Kalvidam Brahma, Pragnanam Brahma, then I am Atma Brahma. There are two other Mahavakyas. I am Atma Brahma is one of the Mahavakyas. Now, today's entire session is going to be about understanding I am Atma Brahma. We'll go step by step. First, we'll understand how I am Brahman. Then we'll worry about tear, Eiffel Tower and other things, whatever I see. First, let's focus on the seer. Then we'll go to the scene. You understand? So there is a seer and there is a scene. How the seer is Brahman, then we'll resolve how seen is Brahman. even if the seen is Brahman, and if I am an individual seer, the problem is not solved, because fine, that is all, that is Brahman. But how does that change my life? Brahman is still troubling me. The seen is still troubling me, right? For the seen to stop affecting the seer has to be resolved. So I am Atma Brahman first, then sir, whatever I see. Like in the dream, just because you realize that the Eiffel Tower is me or the other person is me, doesn't help. Who am I? And I'm still perceiving the dream. If I know I'm the waker, then I'll immediately wake up. So focus on waking up rather than trying to resolve the dream. Okay, so I am Atma Brahman is a statement made in realization that I am Atma Brahman. The Rishi who says the Mahavakya is saying with complete conviction and clarity, I am Atma Brahman. In many spiritual texts, they say that the Rishi beats the chest and says, I am Atma Brahman. Okay, he's practically saying, I am God. Now, what is this God? Are we referring to somebody with four hands, somebody who has command over the universe, somebody who has magical powers, somebody who can manifest things at will? None of that is God. What you understand, what you know God as, is not God. Because God cannot be known. The knower is God. The supreme reality is God. How that is so, is what is the journey today. So is it clear so far? So now we are embarking upon the journey of I am Atma Brahma. I am Brahman. So right now, can you confidently say I am Brahman? You can say?
Yeah,
already one. See, 10 minutes into class, I have an enlightened person who is ready to say I am Atma Brahman. No, it's good. What?
No, like, I've heard this
before. You heard this before. So you have any doubt that you are not Brahman?
No.
Not at all. Very good. You have doubt that you are Brahman? Lots of doubt. You also can't say?
No.
You can say?
No.
Just say no. Just pretend to say. I am Atma Brahman. I am Brahman.
It does not feel very honest.
It does not feel very honest. Enlightenment is that does not feel any honest doesn't exist. In you and in the enlightened person, the only difference between what you call as so-called enlightened being and unenlightened being is that the enlightened being has no confusion to say, I am Atma Brahman. Because they know clearly, there's no doubt in the mind that says, I am not Brahman.
But people get really hassled when you say that. We're okay accepting that God is everywhere. But God is in us. That's just wrong. Why is we questioning that God can't be in us?
Correct. No, here I am Atma Brahman is not God is in you. You are Brahman.
Right?
Yeah. No, when you say God is in you, you're again referring you as body.
Yeah.
So here I am Atma Brahman is, my consciousness is Brahman. And I am not the body. So we'll explore it. We'll get into that now. So far, the problem is this Upanishad is making a statement, I am Atma Brahman. And clearly, it is not my conviction. How can I resolve this internal conflict? The internal conflict is, I have been taught I am something, and I experience myself as something, and I have individuality. And Brahman means something else. Brahman means infinite. Brahman means supreme reality. There is no match between them. How can I resolve this conflict? So let us get into I am Atma Brahman. Clear so far? Anybody else on the online is ready, but has clear conviction to say I am Atma Brahman? Pallaviji, very good. All right.
No, saying yes, I can say, but again, the conviction is less.
So saying is not, you can say, but say without any conflict within. Enlightenment is enlightenment is not even saying, the enlightened person doesn't declare I am Atma Brahman. It's just for teaching. But the enlightened person has no conflict of who I am. The Upanishad is just pointing out, so you have various notions of who you are. It tries to break it down. What it does, I'll get into now. And how Omkara is fits into this. And how it plays out into the three things that I experience. Me, world, and beyond that. So bringing a complete, sort of connection, correlation between me, world, that, and Om is what the Mandukya operation does. Are you ready? You need some brain stimulation for I am Atma Brahma. Okay. Shall we start? Okay, I think Sheshadriji, are you here now? Okay, we are just now starting. The shloka says, Sarvam Hetat Brahma, everything is Brahman. I am Atma Brahma and Soyam Atma Chatushpa. We're diving deep into I am Atma Brahman. First, let us understand how I is Brahman, and then we'll go to how everything else is Brahman, and the four, what are these four aspects of Brahman? So these are the three main points that we'll discuss and inquire into in today's session. First thing is I am Atma Brahman. See, so typically when you wake up, your nervous system is what you perceive. Your sense organs are dependent on the operation of the nervous system. And you get a lot of inputs. The nervous system is bombarded with data. So our nervous system is basically a data processing unit. All right. And it has some fundamental programs. It is a result of a lot of evolution. Okay. And it carries a lot of evolutionary insights, right? And a lot of these, and the primary evolutionary tendency of the nervous system is flight and fight. Two responses. It only knows two responses, fight and flight, because that is the operation in an environment like forest. There's only two things. You either fight or you flight. And the same thing gets carried over in human behavior. Every decision you make, you're actually very at a deeper level only taking flight or fight decisions. Even if you're going after joy, it's a flight mechanism, running away from suffering. And this constant input coming to the nervous system, it shakes the system, meaning it makes the system, it disturbs the system. So think of it like a silent pond. The water is still. Then the wind will blow. And there are ripples in the water. Okay, and the wind never stops. It continuously, there are ripples in the water. That's what happens in the ocean. In the ocean, the waves rise and fall, waves rise and fall, right? Because of the movement of the wind. But is the ocean like that? Is that the reality of the ocean? If you go deep into the ocean, what is the ocean? It's tranquil, it's quietness, it's peace, it's stillness. There's no sound, no light. It's absolutely quiet. There's no up and down. There is a stillness in the ocean, deep within the ocean. At the surface level, because of the movement of the wind, there are a lot of waves. But that is not the reality of the ocean. The reality of the ocean is the deeper part of the ocean. Same thing with us. The mind has a lot of thoughts. Thoughts are like waves. keep rising because of your interaction with the world. That's all. Okay. Even when you stop the interaction, you carry the memory, and that disturbs the mind. That's constantly a input to the nervous system, and the machine keeps running, and the top layer is always disturbed. But if you go deep within the mind, deeper and deeper within yourself, just like the ocean, there is tranquility. There is deep silence. No noise, no thought, no object, no God, no you, no world, no duality. In the waking, there's a duality, other and me. In the deep ocean, in the deep mind, there is no duality. There is no that, there is no me, and there's no requirement for any teaching. There's no requirement for any meditation. There's no chai, no seeking, right? Because there is a stillness, there is a silence. There's nobody there, no body. There are no bodies. There is no trouble. There is no flight and fight required, because what will you fight in the non-duality? And that is what you experience in your deep sleep. In deep sleep, unconsciously, you touch the bottom of the ocean. Unconsciously. But you again come back to the surface. And you're constantly doing that. Touching, coming back. Touching, coming back. So there is a deeper you. And that you is not lost in deep sleep. In that silence, you're still there. But you are not identifying with anything. Right? But you touch that and come back to waves. Touch the deeper, come back to waves. Right? The problem is you're touching, coming back, touching, coming back. Is there any way to touch and stay without coming back? Okay, and that not coming back, and what is happening in that not coming back? There is a non-duality, there is a stillness, there is a experience of no inner and outer, no me and that. This is the deepest level of my consciousness. That level, that consciousness is called supreme consciousness. That is a state of existence even right now. Okay, from the perspective of existence, existence is like that. That's why Narayana is shown sleeping on the serpent at the bottom of the ocean. Okay, so Narayana, the supreme consciousness, Brahman, when I use the word Narayana, Shiva, Brahman, please understand I'm only referring to one supreme consciousness, formless, non-dual reality. And that reality, which is also your reality, is in that state all the time. It's never come out of that state. So Narayana is eternally shown as sleeping, meaning it's a state of non-duality, like in the state of the bottom of the ocean. And there is a projection in that reality, like how the ocean is tranquil, but on the surface there are waves. In the same way, some waves, there's some movement somewhere in that supreme reality. And it's not at all significant. It's just a small blip in existence. And that small blip is what you see as physical world. All the thousands of the multiverses, the galaxies, planets, buildings, human beings, animals, suffering, life. Everything happens in that small bubble that arises in that ocean, in that tranquil ocean. In that supreme reality, there is no notion of me or other. There's no duality. That's existence. And that existence is in the state of Sat Chit Ananda. Sat is, it exists, it is reality. That is the only reality. Chit is, it is consciousness. Ananda means it is in bliss because there's nothing else. And that consciousness cannot move. It's like telling space can move. Can space move? What will it move to? Consciousness is what holds space. There is no movement. There is no creation. There is nothing in the consciousness. And that's the state of the consciousness right now. Not that that's how it was. Even at this moment, consciousness remains to be in a state of non-duality. and there is the appearance of the world. The world, let's go back to how it started. The consciousness, because it is chit, has a deep urge to know itself. Infinity cannot know itself. Okay, there's no way the consciousness can know itself. To know itself, it has to become finite. Like you can never see yourself. The eyes see everything, but can the eyes see themselves? You see a reflection in the mirror, but the reflection is not the eye, right? Your eyes that see everything, that show everything, can never see themselves. Consciousness can know everything, it can never know itself. Okay, because knowing means to know something. If I know this piece of cloth, I am the knower, this is the known. Consciousness can never become the known, because there's no, to have an experience of known, there should be a knower and known, seer and seen. In consciousness, that is impossible, because it is non-dual. In the non-duality, there cannot be a separation of somebody who is knowing and something that is known. You understand why consciousness cannot know itself? The supreme reality can never know itself. And in that non-knowing, there's the urge to know itself. And then the entire world appears like a dream. And that's why Brahma appears out of the stomach navel of the Narayana. It's the rishis were trying to explain this truth graphically. So they showed Brahma. Brahma is the creator. And before the creation happened, there's an urge in consciousness. What am I? To know. Now for the urge to come, there should be I that has to come. You understand? If there's no I, there's no urge. Who has to know it themselves? So the first thing that appeared in consciousness is the sense of I. And the primordial sense is called Omkara. The primordial urge to know itself is Om. It's the first manifestation of Om. Then that Om becomes I. It gets more solidified. I am, I exist. It becomes Aham, I. And it becomes, so if I am there now, is there something? In consciousness, there's nothing. So there's a projection, imagination. Okay, so it's the same ability you also have. You can imagine, I can sit and imagine apple. I can see the apple. Okay, but in consciousness, because it is supreme consciousness, if it imagines apple, apple will really appear. You understand? It's not really there, but it's an appearance. It shows up. So then came other, idam. So aham and idam. In something where there was nothing, there's no I, there's no other, came first time aham and idam. Understand? Me and the world. I see the world, but I need to experience the world. And the consciousness cannot experience the world as the pure I. So the pure I identifies with a body to experience the world. And that identification with the body creates the jiva, individual. I, you, me, everybody. So I can say the supreme consciousness is Shiva and the creation is Shakti. And when the Shiva identifies with a creation of Shakti, the body, to experience Shakti, it becomes Jiva. So Shiva and Shakti, so the husband and wife meet, there is a child, and the child is you. Shiva and Shakti meet, there is a child, and the child is Jiva. The Jiva is nothing but Shiva. The problem is, the Jiva now cannot see Shiva. He cannot see Aham. He only sees Idam, he or she. The body has only sense organs to experience. Whatever is seen by the sense organ, what is known by the sense organs, becomes reality. And whatever is beyond the sense organs is not paid attention to. And the body, this child, this jiva, there's no way the jiva can know itself. What it starts doing? To know yourself as a child, what do? The mommy comes and tells you, the baby. Baby, you're such a cute baby. So chubby, you know, all that. Such a beautiful baby. Chand ka tukda hai tu. You're the most beautiful in the world. Then the baby goes and sees, am I really like that in the mirror? And then it starts feeling, okay. Now it's got the first notion of itself as what? The baby, when its mother is telling, it's getting input, you know, auditory input. The first time baby gets a visual input about itself, when it sees a reflection. When it sees a reflection, the notion that I am body gets solidified. I am this. Okay? And then it starts interacting with the world. Everybody starts giving a notion to the baby. You're not that. Your mother said you're beautiful, but you're very ugly. Okay? Then somebody says, you're very intelligent. Somebody says you're stupid. So it gets contradictory inputs about itself. And none of the inputs are about the real I. Okay? All the inputs are about some perception that person is having. Okay? And slowly all these perception become conflicting notions about yourself. So you have a notion that I am loved and I'm unloved, both. Because your mother loves you, you have a notion that I am loved. Because the person that you love doesn't love you, you have a notion that I am unloved. Okay? Because somebody told you you're beautiful, you have a notion that I'm beautiful. Then all the Instagram dislikes tell you you're ugly. Okay? Then you see a more beautiful person and you yourself tell. So you're a bundle of notions about yourself. And none of those notions about I. What are all the notions about? Body. All those notions are about body. And you are confusing you are the body. The consciousness, the infinite, took a finite form to appreciate the infinite and go back to the infinite. That was the only purpose, okay? That was the only purpose of creation. You appear, and it's not creation as in the sense that we call creation. It's a dream. You go into the dream, you associate with, even to experience a dream, you cannot be flying in the air, right? You can't experience a dream. Even in the dream, you associate with some dream body, right? Have you ever had a bodiless dream? You know, even if you don't have a body, you have some object. You identify with the object with some sense perception to experience the dream. Same thing happened to consciousness. It identified with the body, had an experience, but in the process of experience, got deluded. Forgot who it is. Forgot I am infinite. Started thinking I am object. Forgot that it's a subject. Started thinking it's the body.
So the Supreme Consciousness
didn't get confused. No, for the Supreme Consciousness point of view, this has never happened. Even right now, it's like that only. The deep part of the ocean is still like that. All this mess is just movement of the waves. Even right now, there is no creation. Even right now, you are in that supreme state. But you're paying more attention to the waves. You're not paying attention to the deeper you. So the Upanishad is helping you shift your attention to the non-duality. Is it clear? So you go on questioning about the waves, why the wave is rising, why this is happening, why there's suffering in the world. It won't solve the problem. You need to go back to the source. So in corporates, we have a system called five whys. Right? We ask five whys to solve a problem. Somebody makes a problem statement, you ask why. Then there's an answer given. It is because, okay, why there's a garbage problem in Bangalore? Why there's a garbage problem in Bangalore? Because people are careless. Why people are careless? Because they don't have a sense of, they don't care. They don't care about the other. They want to get rid of their problem. Why they want to get rid of their problem? Because there is no governance. There is no solution. If somebody is providing them a better solution, they would rather choose that. So if you go on asking why, you'll go to the core problem. And you address the core problem, everything else gets resolved. So in the same way, the core problem of existence is I. Or rather, the misconception of I with the seen and not the seer. You understand? So in trying to, from knowing the infinite, the consciousness identified with the finite, experienced a dream, but got lost in the dream. Shiva became Jiva, but lost in Shakti. That is the story of Ganesha. Ganesha wants to kill his father, Shiva. The child only knows the mother. And when the father comes to meet the mother, the child doesn't allow. The child is ready to kill. Because the child doesn't know the father. The father is consciousness. The mother is nature. You only know the objects. You don't know the seer, the subject. Okay? And that problem is being resolved. Should we go ahead? So far, the logic is clear. First, I put the problem statement, why we arrived here. Okay? To go back. Roadmap. So in the non-dual consciousness, there is an appearance of idam and aham. And that aham is identified with body and mind. And that body and mind is illuminated to experience the dream. And that in that contact, in that association with a dream body, there is another aham born, which is called jiva, which is ego. What you say as I right now is a jiva, is an ego. It's not that real I. You know actually the real I, but what you refer to I as is the ego. Okay, so if you see through the ego, the entire spirituality is about getting rid of the ego, right? Right? Entire spirituality, you read the spiritual text, it's about drop your ego, let go of your ego, right? Everybody uses the word ego and dropping the ego. So I am Atma Brahma is seeing through the ego and practically dissecting the ego. We'll strip down the ego today. Before we do that, I just told you how the ego appeared. You understand? How it appeared? Is there any doubt in how it appeared? In the non-dual consciousness, there is a urge, and that urge is omkara, and that urge becomes aham and idam. Idam is also omkara, aham is also omkara, akara, ukara, makara. So I told in the last session, what is the specialty of akara, ukara, makara? How in the TV, you see millions of colors, but there's actually only three colors. Red, blue, green, RGB. But mixed in various proportions, you see millions of colors. In the same way, a, u, ma, which are called as anahata dvani. Anahata nada means, anahata means for any sound to happen, the two objects have to come in contact. Any sound. To speak, your vocal, your tongue has to touch, hit somewhere. Omkara is anahata. It is unstruck sound. In the Zen philosophy, it's known as the sound of one hand clapping. Unstruck sound. And that it's called unstruck sound because to say a, u, ma, your tongue doesn't move. Tongue doesn't move. Without moving the tongue, you can say a, u, ma. Every single sound, the tongue should move. So whatever you see in the world is only two things. What is this? What is this, Vivek?
Cloth.
What is the purpose of this cloth? It's a coaster, right? Is it?
Yes.
It's a coaster. It's a cloth. The cloth has two aspects, name and form. The name called cloth and the form called cloth. All right? The name is what? Om. Cloth, the word, is the cloth word cloth? No, it's a pointer to the cloth. The name itself is not the form. The name is a pointer to the form. The name is Om. Every name, every word, name is a word. Every word is only a mixture of akara, ukara, makara. Any word you say. Every name is akara, ukara, makara. Every form, what is this form? What is this form made up of? It's made up of thread. Thread is made up of cotton. Cotton is made up of atoms and molecules. Molecules are made up of subatomic particles. Particles are made up of, particles have two behavior. They are either a wave or a particle. Their energy. What is this? Energy. Every form is nothing but energy, and that energy is called Shakti, and that energy is Omkara. So Om is both the name and the form. What you are experiencing is only Omkara. So the urge Om becomes the vibration. Om becomes the solid world, which is Om, and then the experiencer, you. Everything is there, but there is no conscious experiencer. It's useless. Like the everything is there in the computer. It shows movies, it shows songs, it shows everything, but none of it makes sense unless there's a conscious being to experience it. You understand? So everything is Om, and these are the four levels of Om, called as Para. Repeat after me: Para, Pashyanti, Madhyami, Vaikari. These are the four. Layers of Om. At the Para level, it's the urge in consciousness. It is still unseen, unknown, nothing. It's just an urge. Para. Om. At the Pashyanti, it becomes Aham and Idam. At the Vaikari, at the Madhyami, it becomes name and form. Okay, solid. At Vaikari, it becomes Om, the word that I'm saying right now. Om. The word Om. The actual saying of Om. So when you say Om, you can only refer to the Vaikari, which is the most superficial Om, just the word Om. It's actually representing Para, Pashyanti, Madhyami, Vaikari. When you're saying Om, it encompasses everything. That's what we saw in the first shloka of the Mandukya Upanishad. In the first shloka of the Mandukya Upanishad, if you remember, I said everything is Omkara. Now you understand how everything is Omkara? From the urge to the aham idam, to the solidification of the universe, or appearance of solidification, not reality, appearance, and then the sound Om. These are the Para, Pashyanti, Madhyami, Vaikari. Now our journey is from Vaikari. We're at the Vaikari level, the gross level. We need to go back to Para and stay in Para. You understand? At the Vaikari level, I am Jiva. Okay. At the Madhyami level, I am energy. I am my mental images and thoughts. At the Pashyanti level, I am more subtle energy, memories. And at the Para level, I am Brahman. And when the Upanishad makes the statement, I am Atma Brahma, it's told in reference to Para. My consciousness is Brahman. My appearance is Vaikari, but my consciousness is Brahma. You understand? Now we'll logically go back from Vaikari to Para. So far, any doubts? Offline people? Lakshmi? Anybody else? Any questions, Vivek? So online, people online. So far, is it clear how we got into this mess? How the Jiva became Shiva? Sorry, how the Jiva became Shiva became Jiva. Now we'll go how Jiva to trace back Jiva to Shiva. But before we do that, any questions? Kundanji? Everybody's following the logic. Everybody's silent online.
Yes, dear Krishnaji.
Okay. So now we will logically go back from Jiva to Shiva. How I am Atma Brahma. Okay. And the whole game of I am Atma Brahma lies in the ego. The entire spirituality is about ego. What you fall at the feet of enlightened people or masters, anybody, with the notion that this person doesn't have ego. The child has no ego for some time. Okay. Later, the ego is, it arrives. Now, the entire spirituality is about becoming free from the ego. So ego is made to be a very a gigantic monster that you need to get rid of. What is typically called in the spiritual tradition as asura, rakshasa. It's an inner demon. It's become an inner demon, but it's nothing like that. It's only a misconception in misinterpretation of a perception. So we'll go into inquiry into ego right now. Shall we go ahead? Okay. Now this ego that you say, what is the ego?
Notion of self.
Notion of self. You don't have ego. No ego. What is ego? What is ego for you? Notion of self. Notion of herself or yourself? What is ego? You have ego? What is it? Huh?
Get hurt
or something that gets hurt a lot. Dina, you have ego? Ego. What is ego?
Sense of individuality.
Sense of individuality. Anybody else has any different answer? What is ego? Prasad?
That which is identified with something that it, that not it, that it is
Technical
not.
Answer. That which is identified. Okay. Very true. Very good. That which is identified with body mind. Okay. So anybody else? Anybody? Any other answer?
I am the doer.
I am the doer is the ego. Okay. So ego is basically I thought. It's a I thought. It's not I. It's not a real I. It's a I thought. You understand? When it's a I thought, if that I thought is not there, you have no experience of ego. So do you have ego I thought all the time? Do you have it all the time? When you wake up in the morning, there is still no I thought initially. Then you say, oh, I'm awake now. You identify, start identifying with the body. That I thought start getting identified with the body and mind. There's an I thought that arises, identifies with the body and mind, says, this is me, and starts doing, starts working. That is called as ego. Ego is I thought, identified with the body and the mind. Or forget the mind. What is mind? What is mind? Ego is I thought. Okay. No I thought, no ego. If there's no I thought, is there any point to say ego? Let's say you don't have I thought. Do you not have I thought? So I asked, do you have ego all the time? No. Let's say you're immersed in some activity, painting. Okay. I do painting. So I'm immersed in, I love painting. So I'm immersed in painting. Let's say you're immersed in the activity that you love. Coding. What activity you love? Painting. Huh? Painting. Okay, I heard as eating. What activity you love? Music. Music.
Painting, meditation.
So when I'm immersed in that mythology, what activity you love?
Listening music.
Listening to music. So these activities, the activity that I love, when I'm immersed in that activity, there is no I thought. There's no ego. After the activity is over, I thought appears and says, I heard the music, or I painted, or I cooked, or I ate, or I had fun with my friends. When you're immersed in the activity, there is no I thought. Sheshadri, is this clear? I'm sorry, I forgot the name of your wife.
Suman ji,
clear?
Getting slowly.
So, no, we are inquiring. This is a very important thread. Okay? It's about dissecting the ego. Our whole problem is ego. Ego is I thought. Is there any doubt in that?
No.
And I thought is not continuous. The I thought is continuous is a thought that appears later. Continuously, I have I thought, karke ek thought aayega, baad mein. But it's not, it's also another thought. It's not a continuous thought. I have thoughts continuously is a one thought. Why is it so? Because what you call as mind is a mind is an entity which can have only one thought at a time. Mind is an entity which can have only one, which can hold only one thought at a time. It's like a vocal cord. It can make only one sound at a time. It's like a movie projector. It can show only one frame at a time. Even if you show multiple frames, it's one frame. But the frames are appearing consecutively so fast, you experience a movie. Right? Movie is what? Multiple frames, I don't know how many frames, multiple panes per second. So it's actually like this. But it appears like that because it's being played fast. So mind is one thought at a time appearing consecutively without gap or without a notion of gap. So gives the illusion that there is a continuous person, that I'm a continuous person. But I thought, is it continuous? I just told you, you don't have I thought when you're doing what you love. You don't have I thought many times during the day, actually. You think you have I thought. Sometimes when you're just not doing anything, you don't have I thought. Suddenly you recognize, oh, it's time, or you become aware of the body. When you become aware of the body, when your attention goes to the object, the I thought appears. Oh, I am seeing the object. I am there. You understand? But when the I thought is not there, are you there? There's no question. There's nobody to say I'm there or I'm not there. It's irrelevant. The question itself is irrelevant.
When you're eating ice cream, you're so much lost in that bliss.
When you're eating ice cream, there's no I thought. There is bliss. So I thought is not continuous. First thing to understand. Ego is not continuous. Okay? And you're afraid of something that is not even continuous. Now, if it's not continuous for you, is it continuous for the other? For you yourself, the I thought is appearing and disappearing in your consciousness. So there is a consciousness, which is consciousness, which is your existence. You exist. In that existence of you, I thought appears. Okay? And it disappears. Okay? You understand? And that I thought that appears, it doesn't sit quietly. It associates with the body and mind. Now the I thought that appears starts associating with the, from where it appeared, is mukti. If it associates with the body and mind, it is bondage. Is it clear? The I thought is appearing, and because of all my programming, I'm focused on the object. If the I thought traces its source, it goes back to the subject. That's why Ramana Maharshi breaks his head. There's a master called, enlightened master that lived, called Ramana Maharshi. He always used to say, inquire, who am I? And trace the source of thought. Trace the source of thought means this. Go back and see from where is the I thought coming. So we'll do that now, step by step. First step clear, I thought is not continuous. First statement. Any doubt, any challenge for this statement? Is the statement clear? I thought is not continuous. Nanu, me, is not continuous. Nenu, which other language people are here? What do you call I in Bengali, Mithali ji?
Ami.
Ami. Ami, nanu, me, I. Is not continuous. It's a thought that appears. First statement. We'll go next level. Next level, mind can only hold one thought. There can never be multiple thoughts in the mind. Any challenge to this? Vivek, is it clear? Mind means only one thought. Like your vocal cord can only make one sound. After one sound is done, it can go to the other sound. Then you say, no, I can multitask. I can do so many things at one time. But so many things at one time are actually one thing after the other happening rapidly. So you're eating and you're typing. You're shifting fast between two activities. When you're eating, your body is although moving, but you're not aware or conscious of that process. It doesn't exist. Only when you shift your attention to the typing, then you hold that. Then that is a reality. Eating is not a reality. You might be chewing, but it is beyond your experience. For you, what you're paying attention to is your experience. So mind can only pay attention to one thought at a time. That one thought is called mind. Mind is not thousands of thoughts. The thousands of thought is one thought. It comes and tells, oh, you had thousands of thoughts, which you never had. Doubt. At any moment, you have only one thought at a time. Mind cannot hold more than one thought. In that one thought, there is a thought of me and there is a thought of other. Okay? There is a thought of experiencer and experienced. I am seeing the napkin is one thought. I am seeing the napkin. So what is there? I am there. Napkin is there. Seeing is there. Now the process of seeing connects the seer and the seen. If there's no seeing, there's no perception possible. So the seeing process connects the seen and the seer. We are not worried about the seen. What is seen, we'll see later. How seen is Brahman, we'll see later. Don't worry about the seen. Let's only focus on the seer. Okay? Now, next level. Ego is I thought. There can only be one thought at a time. The thought, the I thought, I, is it the subject? Is thought a subject or object? You understand the question? So this is object. I am seeing it. I am a subject. Okay? Now forget about the object. Forget about this object. Let's make the thought as itself as the object. The thought that I have, the I thought that I have. The I thought, is it the subject or is it the object? Is everybody getting the question?
Object.
Vivek, can you give me the board? Hey, let's illustrate this. Thought is the object because you can see it, you can know it. Clear? Like how you can know the hanky, you can know the I thought. You can also know, and you can say, yeah, I didn't have I thought when I was working, right? Because it was no, there was no objective experience. Is it confusing to people? Few more steps and we'll go into Shiva. Nothing is there. It's just the I thought. And this whole I thought ruins or gives an illusion that my life is ruined and makes people do so many crazy things, including seek enlightenment. Okay, can you all see the board? All right. So there is I. Okay, so this is I, what you know as I right now. What you right now say, me. Me. Now what is this me? It's actually I thought. It's I thought. But it is confused with body and mind. The I thought is confused with, is a body object or subject? Object. Is mind object or subject? Object. So mind, body, world all belong to the category of the seen, the experienced. Okay? Is it clear, Vivek, so far? So all this is the seen, the known. Is the I thought? So the known is known by the knower. Right now, who's the knower? Who knows the body? I know the body. Right? Who knows the body? I know the body. That I know the body is a I thought. The, when you say I know the body. I thought appeared. Wait for my boss. To make sure the logic, I don't deviate from the logic. So body, mind, world is experienced. It's the object. It's a scene. And the scene has to be, is known and experienced by the experiencer, the seer, the knower. You say, who knows the world? Who knows the body? I know the body. Who's the I? The I is the I thought. The I thought appeared and said, I know the body. This I is a I thought. It's a thought. Now the thought is also known. It's not the knower. Is the thought object or subject? Is I thought object or subject?
Object.
It's an object. So who is knowing the I thought?
It's I again, which is the subject.
Who is that I?
Who is the I? The conscious.
And so in your experience, so in your daily experience, let's say I had a cup of tea. When I had a cup of tea, the mind says, tea is the experienced, body is the experiencer. Correct? Vivek, when you have a cup of tea is the experienced, body is the experiencer. But is the body experiencer? Body is not the experiencer. Body is also experienced. The mind is drawing a wrong line. Spirituality is about drawing the right line, that's all. It's drawing a wrong line of where I end and something else, object, where subject ends and object begins. It's drawing the wrong line. It's drawing the line of the body. It's saying body mind is me. What I see is world. Body mind is also the world, part of the world, because I see it.
So you have a question. So you say the conscious here to the higher conscious is here.
Huh.
Experience.
Okay.
And if there is no experience, there isn't a futile exercise.
No, we'll come. I'll address the experience part of it. There is an experience. We are here questioning as to who is the experiencer. We don't have a problem with experience. Experiences, today I have this experience, tomorrow I have that experience. What is always there is I. Okay, we're not worried about the experience. We're worried about who is the experiencer. Why who is the experiencer? Because what I think as the experiencer is going through, if body becomes the experiencer, does the body, can the body always be in one state?
Yeah.
Health? No. The body will go through disease. So if the body goes through disease, I as an experiencer also suffer.
Like with the mind also, right?
Same thing with the mind. Yeah, exactly. So whatever I identify with limits me.
Mm-hmm.
If I identify with my body, the limitations of body are superimposed on me. So if the body has certain limitation, I have limitation. Okay, that is fine. Body still has limitation that everybody has a limitation. But when the mind has a limitation, I have a limitation. That is a problem. Okay. So now I'm associating with something that has a limitation. If you're happy with that association, continue. Go on. Go on associating with the body and mind. But sometime we'll say, I intuitively know that I'm more than this. Why am I suffering? And there's a seeking of coming out of this association. And the only way to come out of the association is to inquire into the I. That's what we're doing now. So first we understood that I is nothing but an I thought. The I thought is associating with the body and mind. That association is also a thought. The I thought is also an object in me. Is this part clear? I itself is a thought that appears momentarily. And any time you say, I heard this lecture, I cooked, I did the project, I completed the project, I made money. Every time, you are actually confusing the knower with the known. I ate food. Who ate food?
Body.
Body ate food. What did I do?
Enjoy.
Did the I enjoy? body ate food, body had a physical reaction, the good sensation, comforting sensation. The mind, because the body, let's take chai. Okay, whoever doesn't like chai, I assume it's coffee. In the morning, I had a first sip of coffee or chai. There's a good sensation in the body. Because there's a good sensation in the body, the mind became silent. In the silence of the mind, my true nature, which is bliss, opened up momentarily. Okay? And I thought that said, I had tea. Who had tea? Body had tea. The mind became silent and the self's joy was revealed. What did I do? It came and claimed that I did everything. The I thought came and told that without me, this was not possible. You understand? It is the I thought is just making sure there is a continuous entity running, a continuous seer experience and running, so that you exist. But that is not true. You exist in the absence of the story of the I thought. When the I thought is not, I just told you, in your immersion, in your immersion in your activity, there is no I thought. There is no need for a doer. You understand? The action is happening. You're painting, you're eating, or you're coding. The action is just spontaneously, it's a spontaneous movement in existence. Like the wind is blowing. There's nobody to come and claim I am doing it. But the I thought comes and says, after you're done with the, and you close the laptop, the I thought comes. I coded. Because the mind cannot accept there was no doer. Somebody has to be there to do it. You understand? No doer is not acceptable. Somebody has to be there to do it. And who is the doer? I. Who, if you question, who is the I? Body. It says a body did it. You understand? So this is the game that you are stuck in. Now the I thought, let's go back to the core discussion. We were discussing, is the I thought subject or object?
Object.
Object. The I thought is an object. It is a known. Thought can never be the knower. Mind has no ability to know. Okay? So you say pen. I saw the pen. The mind pulled up some memory and it's like a mind is like a computer. It does an image matching and it says pen. It gives a result. But can the computer understand anything? Can the computer has any consciousness to know, okay, this is a pen? Is there any meaning for the computer apart from data? A conscious being, the user of the computer, makes sense. Okay, this is a pen. That conscious being is a knower. The mind has no ability to know. Thought cannot know. When you say I know, the I know is a thought. You know the I thought also. I know thought also. So who are you?
Consciousness.
Somebody say, no, I'm I thought. I'm ego. Can you say now you're the ego? Ego is I thought. In your own experience, the I thought appears and disappears. And every time it appears, it's a new I thought. You understand? It's like, it's not the same I thought that appeared. I saw the napkin. Two I thoughts came. I saw the pen. I saw the napkin. I saw the pen, I thought, is different from I saw the napkin, I thought. It's two independent I thoughts that came in the consciousness. And there's also a thought that comes and tells both these I thoughts are same. Both the seers are the same. So something is seeing the pen. The I thought comes and says, I saw the pen. And when the I thought says, I am seeing the pen, it's referring to the body. Body saw the pen. I saw the pen. I saw the napkin. And it also says, the one that saw the pen and the one that saw the napkin is the same person, which is not the case. There's no way of I thought, this I thought, to know this I thought. Because Mind can only hold how many thoughts at a time? One thought. And the one thought can never know another thought. The thought is insentient. It's a data. Thought can never know another thought. Like object can never know other object. Can the hanky know pen? Can the hanky know the pen? The hanky can never know the pen because both are inert, insentient. Only the consciousness knows. Okay? So I thought, if it's an object, can it know the previous I thought that came? It's coming fresh and telling, I am continuously existing from the time of my birth.
But Guruji, it is very difficult to differentiate between the previously came I thought is different to that of the present I thought. That is, it's very difficult to say that they both are different I thoughts.
Yeah, so the question is,
the third I thought that came and told they both are same is more more promising to tell.
I agree. Agreed. The question is, everybody got the question, right? There's a board. So in my experience, there's I thought appearing. There's another I thought appearing after 2 seconds. And there's another I thought appearing that says these two are the same and all of us are the same. It is very difficult to discriminate between that the I thought is, because it seems like the same thing. You do not have to worry about identifying of which I thought it is. You only focus on what is the real I. Don't worry about the appearing eyes. Understand that they're appearing eyes, that's all. See, if you're throwing away garbage, you throw away garbage in Dublin or you process it? You throw away garbage, right? When you throw away garbage, do you see, oh, what am I throwing? This. You throw, entire thing you throw away, right? So all the I thoughts, be it same, different, whatever, you discard. When I said discard, keep them as thought. Put them into the realm of experienced and focus on the real I. That's all. This is for you to move to the next step. This is not for you to stay there and dig into all the I thoughts that are appearing. Simply put them all in the bucket called I thought and one I thought. There's only one I thought that appears, and the I thought is also object. Any doubt that I thought is not object? Is everybody clear? I thought is object. I thought is object. I know thought is object. So who is the subject? Witness. Sakshi. There's a witness of the I thought. Right? Somebody who witnessed, the conscious being that witnessed the I thought and made sense out of it. There's one witness that witnesses the appearance, the association of the I thought with the body, the disappearance. And the witness is always unaffected. It's a witness is continuous. I thought is not continuous. Okay? And witness can never be objectified. You can never know the witness. You can never see the witness. The one who sees, the one who knows through all bodies is the same witness. And that witness is called Atma, self, capital S-E-L-F, Sakshi, witness. And that witness, and when the Upanishads say, I am Atma Brahma, it is first telling, I am not body, I am not mind, I am not I thought, I am the witness of all of this, and that witness of all of this is Atma. And that Atma, that witness is actually Brahman. How that witness is Brahman, I'll come to that. But first, let's go to the level of saying, I am witness. Any doubt? That I am witness also is a thought, you're saying. It's a statement, it's a thought, I am witness. But you're witnessing that also. Witnessing is not action. Witnessing is continuous. So I should not say witness. When I say witness, it becomes a noun. It becomes a being. It's not a noun. It's not a person. It's not a being. It's a continuous stream. There's no break in witnessing. Is there ever a break in witnessing? When the child is born, it witnesses the birth, growing, the middle age, the teenage, the middle age, then the old age, then death, then post-death, whatever. Everything is witnessed. There's no break in the witnessing. In that witnessing appears a I thought, that I am witnessing. Because of, you don't know about the witness, you say I. And when you say I, you're referring to the body and mind. Whenever you say I, you have a mental image of your body. You see that? Whenever you say I, the person is talking about me. Your notion of me is your body. But is the me body? The body is also an object that you see. And in dream, it's a different body that you see. In deep sleep, it's no body. Lakshmi, are you the body?
No.
In the dream, you have the same body?
No.
In deep sleep, you have any body? In deep sleep, there's no body, like the bottom of the ocean. No forms. But there's still a witness of no form. So you have the continuous stream. And that continuous stream is called Sakshi. And Sakshi is continuous knowing. It's not the knower. To say knower is wrong. Because knower also is known by the Sakshi. Seer also is seen by the Sakshi. Whatever you call a seer subject is nothing but I thought. All you have to do is put a line. Am I the I thought or am I the witness?
What is the line?
No, the whole point of the logic is draw the right line. That's called Viveka. Vivek. It's called Atma Anatma Viveka. Subject, object, clarity. Now you're drawing the wrong line. You're drawing the line where on this side, I am the body and mind. And object is whatever I see. But you forget that body and mind also is seen. And the seer also is actually the seen. You see the seer coming and going, the I thought. The real seer who doesn't come and go, who doesn't speak, who doesn't involve, who only illumines, who only silent witnesses, who empowers, who absorbs, who is real, is the pure witness. Like the bottom of the ocean is the primary on which the waves happen. Okay? Now I'm saying all the waves and the top and everything is just object. Go back, go back, go back, go back into the real, the unchanging. And that unchanging is you, I, the real I, capital I. It's not, that is not I thought. That is real I, existence. The notion that of existence, I exist. That real I is the same for you, same for you, same for you, same for you. In, when I say you, in your own experience, you have multiple I thoughts. But you have a notion that all the I thoughts are coming is one I, and all the I thought that this person is getting is one another I. You understand? In you, there are millions of I's coming. In me, there are millions of I's coming. But the substratum of both the millions of I's is only one I. Which you really are, which is you. Vivek, any?
No, the sense of individuality is so great that common I, whatever make it connect, okay? The I which is my, the witness, which is witnessing my drama versus the witness.
No, forget about that other witness. Only focus on your experience. Are you clear about the I thought? Are you clear that the I thought doesn't, is not continuous? When you, the moment you say that I thought not continuous, all the stories told by the I thought is not real. Your life, your mind, your thinking is only stories played by the I thought. Your I thought goes on telling, stitching up stories. Oh, that person is talking bad about me, or that person is loves me. first of all, you yourself are not a person. I thought itself is not real. It is talking about some inference that it has made, which will disappear with it. And the next time when the I thought appears, it's a completely different I, which doesn't even know the previous I, which is stitched together with memory, of course. Memory I'll take again later some other time, what is memory and stuff. But are you seeing the game played by the I? Not played by the I, to say that game played by the I is referring to it is as a continuous entity, but the delusion of these appearing images that are creating, you're seeing frames and thinking it's a real movie. Forget about what, I'm not talking about the idam world, I'm talking about you. What you say you is frames, you are frames. But there is a real you, of course, but you're not identifying with that. Now the problem will solve, one is by seeing this without this seeing this logic, you cannot go to the real I. Because always you, whatever I you'll imagine as to be a real I. Only after seeing the false, the untruth of the appearing I, can you go to the real I. So have you all seen the untruth of the appearing I? Because only after you see it, you go to the real I. Huh. Anybody had a question?
I have a question. मतलब हिंदी में पूछूंगा कि शरीर का इसमें क्या महत्व है, मतलब शरीर से हम ऐसे जुड़े हैं जैसे कोई भी पेन होता है, इट्स एसोसिएटेड विद बॉडी, हम जो सोते हैं इट्स एसोसिएटेड विद बॉडी, हम लोग जो आई आप बोल रहे हैं, जो अहम बोल रहे हैं, वो तो कंटिन्यूस है, उसकी कंटिन्यूटी है. लेकिन चूंकि ये चेतना का अवस्था अलग अलग होता है, तो इसके कारण जो हमारा अनुभूति होता है वो अलग अलग होता है, तो उस दोनों अनुभूति में ये कंटिन्यूटी को कैसे कंटिन्यूस समझे, मतलब अब मैं कैसे बताऊं कि हम ही है जो सो रहे हैं, हम ही है जो जागे हैं, जो शरीर में दर्द होता है हमको लगता है हम ही को हो रहा है, हम ही को नींद आ रही है, हम ही को भूख लग रहा है, तो ये अवस्था तो अलग अलग है मन के हिसाब से, मैंने जो भी आई थॉट्स, जिसको आप अहंकार को जो भी आप शब्द बोले, तो वो उसमें आई की कंटिन्यूटी को कैसे समझे, कैसे उस आई को फिल्टर आउट करके निकाले कि यही ट्रू आई है,
क्योंकि मैंने बताया नहीं, तो
नहीं अच्छा मुझे लगा यही विषय है, क्योंकि अभी तक हमको यही लगता है कि हम ही कर रहे हैं, हम ही बोल रहे हैं, हम ही सुन रहे हैं, मैं आपसे बात कर रहा हूँ, तो ये आई को मेन आई के साथ मतलब वो बाइंडिंग जो है वो थोड़ा समझा दीजिए कि बाइंडिंग कैसे हो जा रहा है इतना टाइम.
हाँ, तो पहली बात समझना है कि बाइंडिंग नहीं हो सकता. वो जो अहम है ना, अहम ऑब्जेक्ट है. पहली बात समझना है कि जीव और शिव से बाइंड योग नहीं हो सकता. मैं मी एंड दैट कैन नेवर मर्ज. I can never become God. Okay? That I, because it's a thought. In the absence of the I, what remains is God. Oh, I ke absence mein jo hai, wo Bhagwan hai, wo aap hai. Jo aapke experience mein hai, jab aap koi kaam kar rahe hain, tab Bhagwan hi kar raha hai. Okay? Jo kaam ho raha hai, when there's nobody to claim who is doing that is existence only is doing that. It's a happening, it's a universal action, but the I thought comes in later and says I did it. So aap apne sharir ke bare mein bola, sharir mein dard hota hai, to pehla baat samajhna hai ki sharir mera anubhav hai. I experience the body, I am not the body. When there is pain, I say I have pain. Do I have pain?
वो पेन का अनुभव तो करता हूँ, कंटिन्यूअसली करता हूँ, जैसे हाथ में चोट लग गया और मेरा हाथ मेरा टूट गया, तो दर्द तो कंटिन्यूअस होता है ना, तो उससे तो आदमी एसोसिएट एकदम अटैच रहता है कि वो कभी नहीं फील करता है कि मुझे नहीं लगा है, बॉडी को लगा, उसको लगता है उसी को लगा,
वही प्रॉब्लम है. तो शरीर को पेन हो रहा है, अगर आप शरीर को वो दर्द को साक्षी से देखेंगे तो आप देन यू विल सी दैट वो दर्द आपको नहीं हो रहा है. मैं एक एग्जाम्पल दूंगा, ताइवान, शायद ताइवान में या किसी देश में, वियतनाम, हाँ, इन वियतनाम देयर वाज अ रेबेलियन, अ रिलीजियस रेबेलियन, वेयर इट रियली हैपेंड. देयर वाज अ मॉन्क कॉल्ड टिच कोंग डुक, इज अ मॉन्क, बुद्धिस्ट मॉन्क. So the Buddhist monk Thichpong Duc, he sat as a rebellion. He sat on the street where all journalists and everybody were there, and he poured kerosene on himself. He lit himself up. He sacrificed his life for the cause. And there was an American journalist who documented this. There are pictures and everything. When his body was on fire, he didn't move an inch. No scream. No reaction. Complete non-reaction. He was not on any substance. He was not on any drugs. No painkillers, nothing. Normal. That is called titiksha, the ability to observe the body. When you observe the body, it becomes completely objective. Then you're able to observe the pain. And that pain, it'll seem like it's happening somewhere far away to something else. It's not me. That gap is developed, of course, by the practice of a practice called vipassana, which is what Buddha taught extensively, wherein you go on observing the body. You go on, right now the body is very solid. It feels very, solid, and if I hit, it hurts. But that is because you're at the vaikari level. You're experiencing a solidity. The more you sit and observe the body reduces into sensation. What is the body? For you, the body is sensation. My leg is, I feel the sensation of the leg, right? If you sit for a long time and you don't, your legs go numb, you have no experience of the leg. You can see the leg, but you don't have experience of the leg. So if you go on observing the body, the solid body becomes liquid, which is sensation. Go on observing the sensations become waves. They appear and go back. So your body just appears. You see in your own experience, the body appears and goes back. But we don't have to reach that level of detachment or observation of the body. Mukti is about just drawing the right line wherein your mind stops creating the stories. The problem is not pain for the body. The problem is I have the pain.
What you're saying is you not get attached to the body.
No, I'm not saying that. I said you cannot, even if you want to, you cannot get attached to the body. Because there's no attachment possible between subject and object. What is the object?
Like how some people are very careful about how their body.
Yeah, narcissist. So how the body looks, they want to maintain the body. All that is fine. That's fine. All that is fine. Here is not about the attachment to the body. The question is, who am I? As long as whatever, even Krishna is taking care of his body. Okay, he wakes up and does yoga and pranayama at 3 o'clock in the morning. Buddha also took care of his body after some time. That is an action. Action is never the problem. The association with the body is the problem. Thinking I am the body is the problem. So Kundanji, I have not yet gone into how to hold the real I. But before you hold the real I, can you just mute yourself?
Yes.
Yeah. So before we go to the real I, we were trying to become clear of what is the false I. Is everybody clear of what is the false I?
Yes.
Are you the body? Are you the mind?
No.
Mind is one thought. When I say mind, one thought. Are you the psychology? Are you the physiology?
No.
Vivek, can you tell it with conviction? You don't have to say I am Brahman with conviction. All I'm asking is, can you say with conviction, I am not the body. I am not the body. Simply because I see it. It is an object to me. I experience it. Still, it is an object to me. There is a time when I don't experience it. Okay? Now you say, oh no, I experience it. I experience pain. Fine, take painkiller. End that problem. Then you say, no, I have disease. Then you understand the body has a disease. When you're able to draw the right line, you're able to witness the disease. And the disease doesn't affect you and create suffering. Okay? You understand? Otherwise, the disease, when you say, oh, I have the disease, it traumatizes people. The moment when the doctor reveals, right, some you have some issue, some neurological issue or something issue, your life is no longer going to be the same. Many people, a huge percentage of suicides is because some people got diseases. You understand? You're not able to handle that because you think it's happening to you and it's going to limit you in a certain way. But if you know you're not the body, it doesn't limit you in any way. That's why we have so many paralyzed motivational speakers. You know, I forgot the name of the person who doesn't have hands and legs, but he's a very famous motivational speaker. Is it handicap? Right. Okay. So basically, that the notion that I am not limited by the limitation of my body. That's what happened to many soldiers. In war, they lose some body part. Then they go through a special counseling where they're made to reiterate that I am still the same person, even though I don't have the body part. Okay? So the limitations of the body stops limiting you. When I say you, stops creating unnecessary distortions in the mind that I cannot do this, my life is over. Basically, unnecessary thought patterns are stopped when you understand that you are not the body. That's all. There's nothing, there's no use for the self. There's no use for the Sakshi. The Sakshi will always remain the Sakshi. Even if you think attached to the body or detached from the body, it doesn't affect the Sakshi. Sakshi will be Sakshi to both. Witnessing will continue. The only change that will happen is the I thought, there are no unnecessary I thoughts that rise and say, I am incomplete. I am incompetent. I am done. Those thoughts that limit the divine expressions don't appear. That's the only difference. Don't think that has some implication on Sakshi. No implication on Sakshi. If you're disturbed or peaceful, Sakshi is the same. Sakshi knows both. There is disturbed, there is peace. There is joy, there is suffering. There is no suffering, there is suffering again. But Sakshi is always continuous witnessing. So far clear? Shall we go to the next step? Sheshariji, Sumanji?
Yeah, sure.
Clear? I thought is clear. Summarize, I thought appears. I thought is also an object. And that I thought carries the notion that I am the body and mind. But the real I, which is witnessing the I thought, is the real you. Now, what happens when you go back, is the I thought, which is focused on the body and mind in the world, shift the attention to the Sakshi. So it's all about shifting attention only. The way the mind operates is, the mind, to experience and indulge with something, it has to pay attention. When I see the pen, my attention has fallen on the pen and I am able to interact with the pen. Now, when I see the napkin, my attention has fallen on the napkin. And because my attention has fallen on the napkin, my attention on the pen is gone. Okay, my experience is napkin. Even though you might see the pen, but in my experience, my focus is napkin. All right, the mind can only pay attention on one at a time. When the mind shifts the attention on who is seeing, then there is mukti. If it pays attention on seen, it becomes experience of the world. So now let us talk about how do I shift my attention to the seer. Is the question clear? How do I shift my attention to the one who is seeing? Because if it's some physical something, I can turn. Okay? But where is the turn? How do I shift my attention to the scene? The seer. Is the question clear? Okay. When you say, in any experience, like I told you, there are two thought is a frame. one frame. The mind projects one thought. The thought is embedded with two notions, the notion of I and the notion of other. Aham, idam. Aham vritti, idam vritti. So I see the pen. In that one thought, I saw the pen. There are two notions, the notion of the seer and the notion of the seen. And the seen is called idam vritti. Vritti means thought, thought pattern. There's a idam vritti, sleeping. Clear? Idam vritti and aham vritti. Okay. Now, idam vritti is not the problem, because idam vritti is always a thought, always a object. And the object appears and disappears. I see the pen. When I'm not using the pen, it has disappeared from me. It has no relevance to me if it is there or not. When I want it, it appears. Okay. Object always appears and disappears based on my attention. So object is not a problem. Is it clear? Idam vritti is not the problem. The what is creating the problem is aham vritti. Me. So in every experience, the seer, the experiences, seer, seen, and the process of seeing. The seen you have removed. The seen is never the problem, because it's an object. An object can never touch the subject. Is that clear? Object, it's removed. Why? Because it can never reach the subject. Okay? Like the horizon can never touch the sky. It appears that the sky is meeting the sea is meeting at the horizon, but it's only an appearance. The horizon can never touch the sky. So the object can never reach consciousness. Is it clear? The object is an appearance in consciousness. What is an object? This is an object. Can you all see the object? Pen. The pen is a sense input. There's a touch of the pen. There's a sight of the pen. Maybe there's a smell. All these touch, sensory input are thoughts. There's an electrical signal from the pen that goes into my brain. And that signal becomes a thought. So what am I seeing? Am I seeing a pen or am I seeing a thought? Lakshmi?
Thoughts.
It is a perception.
Perception is a thought. And you can only see the Vivek. Your pen, the pen that you can see, is limited by your sense organs. True or false? Let's say you're colorblind. Can you see all these colors? No. You're only relying on your five senses to experience the world object. What is really there, you will never experience. So there are some animals who can experience more than you, who have sensory perception more than you. Their experience of the world is different from your experience of the world. So are you really experiencing the real world, or only how much your senses can get captured? The world, the objects that you experience, when I say world, object. All objects are fragmented experiences. And all experiences, all fragmented experiences are thought. Any doubt in that? If there is no thought, you're seeing the pen, but you're thinking of your boss. You're seeing the pen. The pen doesn't exist because your mind is somewhere else. For you to experience something, there should be a thought about the object. See, right now you're listening to me, right? All the other objects that you know, let's say some other country or some other place, your house, is not there in your experience. It's in memory. I'm not denying.
You rely on experience. So you're not like, if I'm seeing something for the first time, that is an absolute. But if I'm seeing something for the second time, okay, with a relation to it, like let's say somebody threw a pen, now it's a pen. Okay. So my perception is based on the latent experience I've had in the past.
No, so we're not talking about that. We're talking.
You just talk about any thought that arises at any
time. Yeah, I'm talking about, you can only one thought arise at a time. I'm talking about all objects. I'm talking about the reality of an object. I'm talking about reality. We're going back to the real eye. Okay? So to go back to the real eye, there is seer, there is seen, as seen, and there is seen. Now I'm first talking about the seen, which is the object. I'm making a statement that the seen we can discard because seen is nothing but thought in the seer. Any object is an input from the five senses. Okay, and the limitations of your senses limits the object. You're actually not seeing the object. You're seeing a interpretation of the senses. It can be anything.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah, we're talking about that experience, that object, right? If I remove one sense from you, you don't have the visual input of that object at all. Your experience of the pen will only be touch. Okay. Now also that's the case. You're talking about five senses. I'm telling. Maybe there is more to the pen, which you're not able to experience because you don't have the sensation. You don't have the mechanism to take the input. So all sensory inputs go back in the brain and become thought. Is there any doubt in that? So pen is thought. Chair is thought. World is thought. World is nothing but thought of the world. If I remove the thought, you have no experience. You can be in the world seeing things, but it doesn't make any sense to you. Right? So, all objects are thoughts, is it clear? No thought, no object. Practically. And that's what happens in a deep sleep. In deep sleep, there are no thoughts. That's why no objects. Do you experience in a world in deep sleep? Do you ask, where is my body? There is no thought. There is no amriti, no idamriti. No vrittis. It's completely. Is everybody clear? Is the voice clear? Okay. So seen we have clarified. Seen is nothing but, or we have internalized. We have made the object into the part of the subject as thought. Okay. The seeing is the thought of I am seeing. I am seeing. We'll come to the seeing. The seeing depends on the seer. Who is the seer? At the first level, the sense organs are the seer. The eye is a seer. If I see the object, the eye is a seer. Because without the light reflecting in the eye, the brain cannot get the input of the pen. So who is the first seer? Eye is the first seer. Okay, let's say your eye is not fine. Your spectacles is the first seer. You have a problem. You're wearing glasses. Without the glasses, you remove the glasses, you can't see the person. You can't see. Can you see?
No, I'm right.
Okay, so your glasses is the first seer because you are dependent on that. If you remove the glasses, you have no seeing. I can sit here, you think some voice is coming from somewhere. So glasses is the first seer. The eye is exactly like the glasses. It's an instrument. Okay? There's something like how the eyes use the glass to see. Something uses the eyes to see. What uses the eyes to see?
Brain. The brain.
The brain. Okay. The brain uses the sense organs. So the brain is the final interpreter. It interprets the electrical signals from all the sense inputs. And it gives an output. This is a pen. Okay. Who sees that output? Can the brain is a machine. Can the eyes, can the glasses see? It cannot. It needs a conscious entity to make sense. So who makes sense of the image that is interpreted by the brain? Glasses is the first seer. Eyes is the second seer, real seer behind that. Brain is the third seer. And the third seer gives an output. This is a pen. Who sees the output?
The eye thought.
Yes. The eye thought. There is a thought when the image is sent to the, interpreted in the brain, there is some memory that's pulled out. Okay, this is the pen. A word is attached to it. If you see some object for the first time, you cannot articulate what it is. Your brain doesn't tell what it is. There is no thought process because you can't speak about it. You'll tell, there's something, there's some stuff, because you cannot articulate, because there's no, you can't depend on your memory. It's the first time you're seeing an object. But after some time, when you know the, when you, there's a naming process. This is a pen. Where is the naming process coming from? From
programming.
From the programming, from already existing programs. That is the first flaw. You see me, first time you met me, huh? You see me, there's a memory of me, that this person behaves like this, talks like this, sees like this, interacts like this. Next time you see me, your mind, you see, there's an electric signal, me, the brain pulls out memory, he behaved like this the first time. Okay? And it builds expectation. Now I don't behave in that expectation. You, let's say next class, I don't even look at you, I only talk to Vivek. You get hurt. Because you've already connected with the image in the brain. That image in the brain has become part of the subject, me. The memory of me has become a part of you because you were unaware in what is happening within you. You had no filters. You just allowed every information to enter you. And whatever was object has become subject. In your head, am I an object or subject? I'm an object, but I have already become subject. I've become part of you because of our relationship. Next time, if I don't acknowledge that relationship, you get hurt. Who gets hurt?
The ego gets
hurt because it has objectified a subject. Sorry, it has subjectified an object. Spirituality is objectifying subjects. The world is objectifying women. you go, what you need to objectify is all the subject, false subjects that you have objectified. Sorry, subjectified, you make them into objects. See object as object. So now I see the pen, coming back to the logic. Logic is almost over, just patient. Two more steps and we are there. I see the pen, it has gone into my, it's a pen, it's a memory. And now it has become my pen. It is, the object has become a subject. How? My pen. So I see the body. The senses give the input that, I see the body. I see the body is fine. It becomes my body. It only not becomes my body. It becomes I itself, I. I am the body. And where is all this happening? In the process of the scene, which is supposed to be known as an object, because of the process of seeing, unconscious seeing, it has gone in, it has become a thought, and the thought has become reality. Okay? Why the thought became reality? Because you don't know the seer. So now let us go one step further. Eyes, spectacles is a seer, eyes is a seer, interpretation is a seer, I thought is a seer. Who is seeing the I thought? Is I thought also seer? Object or subject? I thought is an object. We established that. So who is seeing the I thought? The one who is seeing the I thought is the real seer. And the real seer sees without any instrument. Until the point of the brain and the mind, there's an instrument required to see. That's why they're not the real seer. The real seer sees in the absence of all instruments. In your dream, you saw Eiffel Tower. Did you have eyes? You had a body. Was that a real body? You had a sense perception? Eiffel Tower you saw? Was the eye real, first of all, in the dream? What did you see the Eiffel Tower with? In the real world, you can say, I'm seeing with my physical eyes. What did you see the Eiffel Tower with? You saw it. You were dependent on instruments. Okay. Everything that is dependent on instrument is not a real seer. Only the independent seer, devoid of all instrument, is a real seer. Who is that real seer?
That's what they say about dreams. Like, whatever, you do not dream about anything, you haven't actually seen.
You can.
That's scientifically.
No, scientifically only you can. Scientifically, of course, you cannot dream of something that is not in your memory.
Yeah, subconsciously or subconsciously you've seen that something.
Correct.
That's what this is. Spiritually, it's completely can.
No, so you don't meet people who have not seen in the dream, in real life?
Sorry?
Do you meet people in your dream who you have not seen in real life?
We probably would, but in, like, let's say I've seen somebody, like I've seen her passively, I don't even know her face consciously, but then, you know, I can dream about it.
That's fine. Whatever is seen, I'm telling, is not real. It is a thought in the dreamer. Is that true? The statement that I'm making is, the Eiffel Tower that you saw in the dream is not a real life, it's not an object, it is a thought.
Because our physical body has experienced it, has seen it somewhere.
No, that's fine. You've seen it somewhere, you again project in the dream, that's fine. I'm not arguing that. I'm telling the scene is a thought in you. What is really there, you can never ever see. Because you have limitation of sense organs. Now I'm saying, I'm trying to understand, seen we have resolved. We're trying to see, resolve who is a seer. The seen is a thought. There's somebody who is seeing the thought. That is a real seer. Who is a real seer? And the real seer is Sakshi. Okay? The Sakshi, and the Sakshi is the same for you, same for me. There's only one Sakshi. It's called Vishwa Sakshi. And the Vishwa Sakshi is seeing all the thoughts. And what is a thought? What is it seeing? What did you see in your dream? Object. Object is thought. Thought is you. All seen is nothing but you. You're only seeing your own self. All thoughts are waves in the ocean. Okay? What is a wave? Wave is nothing but a manipulation of water. What is the reality of the wave? Water. What is the reality of what is seen? The reality of what is seen is thought. What is the reality of thought? Thought is object. Object cannot be, object is insentient. There should be a sentient being to know the thought. So the knowing is the seen. Whatever is seen is nothing but known. It is knowing only. It's a process of knowing. The moment knowing stops, the seeing stops. When I see the pen, I know the pen. The knowing is taken the form of the pen. What? And that knowing is me. Atma. Self. The more I pay in every attention to who is knowing, who is seeing, then the false stories of the I stop. Slowly, gradually, the I cannot fabricate stories. Because the reality is known now. Then there comes a moment where all aham vritti stops in perception. There will only be idam vritti. There will be no I am the body vritti coming up. Who am I? There will be a knowing that I am I. There will be no wrong answers given. You understand? But the interaction with the world will continue. That's what happens to enlightened beings after enlightenment. The aham vritti goes. But they don't disappear from the world. They continue to interact with the world, talk, speak, do everything without a sense of I. And without a sense of other also. The I and the other both are coexisting. They cannot be one without each other. They disappear together. If I goes, the other also goes. Then what remains is only, I told you, we'll come back to seeing. What remains is only seeing. Seen we have removed because seen is thought. Seer is Sakshi. And Sakshi is not seer. Sakshi is not noun. Sakshi is actually seeing, witnessing. So seer we have removed. Whatever seer is there is all false seer. Seer is the ego. Ego, I've told you, is not, it's a I thought. Seer is I thought. Seen is thought. Thought also appears and disappears. What remains is seeing. And that seeing is Sakshi. The three, what your experience of three has now become non-dual. There's no, in seeing, there's no duality. Seeing absorbs the seen and the seer. Okay. Our problem in life is there is a seer, there is a seen, and there's a experiencing, seeing. And the seer is going undergoing to, you're able to see the changes in the seer. And there are thoughts created that I don't like this change. I like this change. I don't like this change. Because you have started associating with objects, which are thoughts. You have subjectified the objective thought. The body is an object. You have made it into a subject. You have made it into me, my body. When it becomes my body, I have like and don't like. I want my body to be a certain way. I don't want my body to be a certain way. You understand? What happens when you subjectify the object? The nature of the object is changed. The object will undergo change. When you have subjectified the object, your expectation is it will not go undergo change. Why you have that expectation? Because that is the reality of the real subject, witness. Witness is unchanging. So you start superimposing the reality of the witness on the object, which is impossible. Object undergoes change. Real subject never undergoes change. Because you have objectified the subjectified the object, you expect the behavior of the subject on the object. Is that possible? Can you expect the body not to age? Can you expect the world not to change? That is the reality of the consciousness. Now you start superimposing consciousness unchanging principle on the world. And in doing so, you experience suffering. The suffering is only expectation not being met. Pain is not suffering. My expectation of I should not have pain is suffering. The child doesn't have suffering. When the child is in pain, it has no expectation I should not be in pain. But the adult has an expectation I should not be in pain. You understand? Right? The adult has an expectation I should not be shouted at. I should not be harmed. I should not be abused. That is the suffering. The hitting itself is not the suffering. So even the enlightened person goes through abuse. Krishna will get hit. But there's no suffering. Because he is not trying to expect the impossible. He's not superimposing subject on the object. He's seeing object as object. It is the nature of the object. You stand behind a donkey, it will kick. You're standing behind the donkey and expecting not to kick is suffering. You understand? The kicking of the donkey is not suffering. Your expectation should not kick is a suffering. You understand? Your expectation that the body should behave like Atma is a suffering. The body dies, Atma is deathless. So this misconception is life. And when you say, I am Atma Brahma, I am Atma, I am not eyes, I am not brain, I am not mind, I am the witness. Can you all say now, I am the witness? Forget the word Atma. Can you all say I am witnessing? Don't worry about witness. Witness is now, like you are solidifying. Witnessing. There is a witnessing principle in you. There is witnessing everything. Witnessing the presence of the I thought and the absence of the I thought. That witness is Atma. And that Atma is this only reality. It's only supreme reality. There's nothing beyond that. I am Atma, Brahma. That consciousness is Brahman. How that is Brahman, I'll take up in the next session. And the last part of the shloka was Soyam Atma Chatushpa, which is this Atma has four quadrants. There are no parts in this witnessing. But from the point of view of analyzing, there are four aspects. The four aspects are waking, dreaming, deep sleep, and beyond, Turiya. So the Mandukya Upanishad talks about Jagrata, waking, Swapna, dreaming, Shushupti, deep sleep, Turiya, which is beyond the three. And our journey is from waking to Turiya. And in each quadrant, there are two. There is an experienced and there's an experiencer. In the waking, I am an experiencer. The waking world is the experience. The waker subject is called as Vaishvanara. And the waking world is called as Virat. I'm just giving you the heads up of what's coming in the next shlokas. That's the first quadrant. Quadrant is about the experiencer Vaishvanara and the experience Virat, the waking world. In the dream, the experience is called as Taijasa and the experience world is called as Hiranyagarbha. Why it's so, I'll explain in the next session when the shloka comes. In the deep sleep, the experiencer is called as Pragna and the experienced, there's no experience in deep sleep, but all the experiences of the waking and the deep sleep become subtle in deep sleep. And that subtle existence is called as Ishvara in deep sleep. And in the fourth, there is no experiencer and experience. It's only non-duality. So our problem is not in the dream. Our problem is not in deep sleep. Our problem is not in Turiya. Where is our problem? Waking state. In the waking state, we are subjectifying objects. And it's an unconscious behavior. And the unconscious behavior is called avidya. It will continue, goes on and on and on for lifetimes. Once the body dies, the mind starts identifying another body. It is perpetual, it goes on and on and on. Until the day, with clarity, you shift back to, I am the witness. In death, at the time of death, if you are able to take your attention back to witness, you will witness the death of the body. And no longer project another dream. But if you don't do that, if you identify with the object, oh, I am dying, something is ending, something will also be created again. This story is over, I'll start another story. You understand? Okay, we went overboard again, even this session for about 40 minutes. Any questions so far? Is a
Vivek ji, एक बात जोड़ना चाहूंगा कि अभी आपने जो एक चीज जोड़ा जागृत अवस्था में इंद्री बोध ही मुझे लगता है कि विषय है और इंद्री बोध से के कारण ही हमको वो सीयर वाली फीलिंग नहीं आती है
नहीं सो ड्रीम में भी इंद्रिया है इंद्रिया प्रॉब्लम सो इन द सेंसेस आर नॉट द प्रॉब्लम द इंटरप्रिटेशन ऑफ द इनपुट ऑफ द सेंसेस इज द प्रॉब्लम The glasses are not the problem. The association that I am the glass is the problem.
So, jagrat avastha mein indri bodh, matlab what I mean to say is like when you are in awakened state, your senses are more receptive than you are in other state.
When you say jagrat, are you talking about the waking state?
The waking state, yeah.
No, it's the same. In the dream, what you perceive a dream world. In the waking, you perceive a waking world. In the dream, when you're perceiving the dream world, you have a feeling that this is real. Okay? I'll take this up in the next session. I'll elaborate more on the sense perception. But the main takeaway from this shloka is I am Atma Brahma. Meaning, understand, know by your own experience and logic that you are not objects or I thought. You are not the ego. You are the witnessing of thoughts, experiences, and sensations. When you pay attention to witnessing, meaning when you just sit without identifying with anything that is witnessed and just sit as the witness, sakshi, then you will realize that you are not the body, not the mind, not the intellect. That realization itself is called as mukti. It will no longer delude you. So what happens in our life is some experience happens, like you get fired. You unconsciously think it's happening to you, right? And your mind starts bombarding you with thoughts. When unconscious living means unconscious subjectifying the object means whatever is happening to the object, you think it's object happening to you. Awakening means, enlightenment means, whatever is happening to the object, witnessing as if it's happening to the object and knowing it's nothing is happening to me. Including death, including disease, including anything in life. What will this do to you? You will never be disturbed. You will never get affected by any external situation. And every situation, you will be able to handle objectively. Like a surgeon doing the surgery objectively. If the surgeon is going to do the surgery on his daughter, then that object is no longer object, it's a subject. Then his hands will shiver. He's not able to take the right action. Enlightenment brings enlightened action. That is the beauty of enlightenment. Krishna is able to bring enlightened action. On the battlefield, he's able to make Arjuna perform. That is enlightened action. If Krishna had subjectified the situation, he will think about his death. Oh, if Arjuna loses, I will die. But he is able to look at the situation objectively. And when you look at a situation objectively, you know exactly what needs to be done. You understand? And that what needs to be done is not coming from memory. Where is it coming from? It's coming from the spontaneous self, from the core, from the bottom of the ocean. Like how the creation is coming from the bottom of the ocean, the knowledge what to do at that moment is coming from the bottom of the ocean. That's called spontaneous action. That's the action of a child. That's the action of an enlightened being. Without getting stuck by subjectifying the object. And that's when creativity happens. That's what is called as magic of the moment. Have you heard the word called magic, the phrase called magic of the moment? In the magic of the moment, when you're immersed without eye thought in any action, something beyond you happens. Okay? There are dancers who dance, when they're dance performing on stage, at certain time, they're able to leap beyond human capability, almost fly. Because they have completely let go of, they're no longer object. With their body, they can't do that. As a real subject, it can happen. It's not a doing, it's a happening. So you're moving from unconscious behavior and action and reaction to a spontaneous creation. Okay? And always a state of undisturbed witnessing. Okay. Enough for today. Any questions before we close?
May I ask one?
Yes, sir.
When the witnessing is in progress,
yeah,
or when the witness has stopped for a moment, then there is a thought comes, I have witnessed. And that witness is by the ego. And once again, that.
No, so witnessing, we are mixing up a few things here. First thing to understand is witnessing is primary. Witnessing is consciousness. Think of it as the bottom of the ocean. Okay? Witnessing is never affected. It is a reality. It has no birth, no death, nothing. It is the primordial existence. In that witnessing appears thoughts, like waves in the ocean appear. It appears. And the witnessing, the Sakshi allows, Sakshi doesn't bother. Then in that projection, there is a body projected, there's a mind projected, and there's an eye thought projected. The eye thought starts associating with the body and the mind. And the witness is not bothered. The witness witnesses even that. The witness witnesses the game of the ego. All right. Now, you, when I say you, the I thought has become, it sort of covers the witness. It completely covers the real witness and pretends that it itself is the I, real I. So yeah, our journey is now unveiling that and going back to the real witness. So having said that, does that clarify what you wanted to know?
Yes. So that means like there is no break in witnessing. Witnessing
never.
Is always there.
Never. Yeah.
It can be superimposed with that I thought or all those things.
Correct.
So taking that, going back, like instead of seeing like, oh, I am witnessing. Like, I don't know. The moment I think I am witnessing, I'm no longer witnessing. I'm in that ego.
Correct. Exactly. You've got the point correctly. Yes. No, you cannot catch it with thought. How will you catch it? The only way to catch it is to be it. The only way to get Brahman, to get Atma, to get Sakshi is to be Sakshi. You cannot catch it as an object. You cannot know it. That's why I started with saying Sakshi, Supreme Consciousness, cannot know itself. Enlightenment means doesn't mean knowing the Sakshi. Enlightenment means being the Sakshi. You can never know the witness. Whoever says, I know the witness now is also a thought. And the witness knows that thought also. Whoever says, I am enlightened is also a thought. Witness is beyond enlightenment. The only way to reach witness is to be witness. That's why it said, Brahmavit Brahmaiva Bhavati. To know Brahman is to be Brahman. And how will you be Brahman? Is in this dialogue of Upanishad, the mind shuts down. The mind cannot say anything. You tell me confidently you are ego. It's like the policeman questioning the thief. You question the ego and it becomes silent. What remains is Brahman. You don't have to do anything. All you have to do is inquire. And that inquiry is called direct path. This is called direct path. Yes. Yeah.
So there's a fact.
There's a fact. Okay.
Reality.
Okay.
Not interpreted reality, but a fact.
Fact is not a reality. Sir.
It is it. That's it.
No. Fact is something objective. It can be verified by two people. That's just fact.
Okay. What is?
What do we call it? Reality.
Whatever it is.
It, that.
Not valuable. What is?
Yeah. So when the reaction comes, ask for whom is the reaction? For whom is the reaction? Is your anger permanent? The shloka, you tell me now. I have spoken for 2 hours. After Ramayana, you're asking, oh, what is the relationship with Ram?
It's not worry about who's called this. It is just about not to worry about this, what I'm seeing, who this here is, and just stay in, okay, this is what I have experienced right now.
The point is to know that. What is the point? The point is to know I am. The point of the shloka itself is the Rishi is making a statement, I am Atma Brahma. And it's not only my reality, it's your reality also. When it becomes your reality, first thing is you will stop subjectifying objects. I already told you what will happen if it's
absolute.
Okay.
You have to summarize.
Let's make the statement again.
If I'm seeing the summarization that there are four stages, these are the four stages.
What are the four stages?
What is,
uh-huh.
Okay, the thought that cause that comes after what is.
Mm-hmm.
There is a emotion that is caused by the thought.
Okay.
And because of the emotion, I may react to any of the ways possible.
Right.
So these are the four stages.
Okay.
Okay. And these four stages are in the making.
Correct.
Okay. There there are subconscious stages, and for the subconscious stages, this all of this experience I have in the two stages stops being after the second stage of the consciousness.
Yes, you've got it right, and you've mixed up with the too many jargons and words. So what you experienced, what you really explained, is a cycle of thought and emotion and reaction. That's one cycle that's different. But what precedes that is the I thought. We're going to deeper. So at the surface level, thought, action, reaction. Okay, thought comes, emotion comes. Because emotion comes, I do some action. And that action gives another impression. And the impression creates another thought. That is the cycle of thought, emotion, and action, reaction. That is the top level. Why this is happening is because of I thought. And that I thought, I told you, is a comes and goes. It's not permanent. It's not a permanent entity. Why the I thought is coming is because of the ignorance of the real self. Okay? And the shloka is talking about what is the real self? What is the real you? So if you know what is the real you, all this will not happen. I thought will not come. Reaction will not come.
Even mind in Turiya is what we are trying to...
No, in Turiya there is no mind. That is what we are trying to say. How my real nature is no mind, no body. That is Turiya. That is reality. That is Sakshi. But I experience world, body and all. To resolve all that, all this explanation. Ultimately, an experience of the bottom of the ocean. No duality. No me. No other. No thought. No world. No I. No suffering. No sound. No silence. Beyond everything. Is that important to get? It's up to you. So Sheshadri, your question was answered. I thought.
Is it okay to ask one more?
Yeah. Please ask. Whoever wants to disconnect, because we have gone overboard. Whoever wants to drop, you can drop. Whoever wants to continue for Q&A can continue for Q&A. Yes, please.
So, kind of witnessing. Then I think, oh, I have witnessed. Fuck. I have gone out of actual witnessing. I'm in the ego. Then come back, like witnessing. Now, oh, I am witnessing. The moment I say I am witnessing, once again, it is not me. I have already gone into the ego.
Yes. The witness knows, oh, I am not witnessing. Oh, I am witnessing both.
Yeah. So so kind of like, even when I think or realize I'm witnessing, I'm no longer witnessing. I've already gone into that ego.
Exactly. Yes. But so witness only... that as the, that's not a problem. Ego coming up is not the problem. To know that I am not this is the gnana.
Huh. So when I'm into the ego, that means when I witness that it is the ego, then witness is in continuous. The only way to be in witnessing or witness is like being continue to be in witnessing. That's all.
Whether you be or don't be, witnessing Sakshi is always Sakshi. Okay? Awareness is always the background. Let's use the word awareness. Awareness is always the background. What happens is your problem is not being aware. Your problem is identifying too much with what you're aware about. You're aware about the body. You're identifying with the body. That's the problem. Being aware of the body is not the problem. Being telling I am the body is the problem. You understand? So how this helps is whenever you're interacting in things in life, your experience in life, whenever something happens, you know that, okay, the hurt is not for me. Somebody shouts at you, the hurt is not for me. The hurt is for some identity in me. And that hurt is also thought. Who am I? Whenever thought comes, you inquire, for whom is the thought? For whom is the emotion? For whom is the pain? What answer you'll get? What answer will you get when you ask the question, for whom is the thought?
There is a background noise. Could you repeat the question?
What answer will you get when you ask the question, for whom is the emotion, for whom is the thought, for whom is the pain? Let's say you lost a job. You ask, for whom is the job loss? Then you say, to me. For who is me? You have some pain in the body. You say, I have pain. Then immediately you recollect the teaching. You ask, for whom is the pain? What answer will you get?
All for the ego.
That is an answer, right? For who? What is the ego? Let's say you further ask, what is the ego then?
A thought.
I thought.
Thought. The more, when you inquire again, from where is the thought coming? What is the source of this thought? When you inquire into the source, you hit a dead end. The mind cannot answer anymore. Okay? The mind will, it cannot say anything anymore. At that moment, you are Sakshi. When you have shut up your mind with Gnana, with Atma Vichara, it's called Vichara, with inquiry, you hit a dead end. At that moment, you are Brahman. Now also you are Brahman. At that moment, there's no noise, that's all. The mind cannot move, answer. Surrender. This is surrender. This is exactly what is called surrender. Surrender means inquiring into the one who has to surrender. Who is there to surrender? Ego itself is not real, I told you. Ego is a I thought. The notion that ego has to surrender is very, it doesn't make sense. Krishna Arpanamastu means leave everything to Krishna is tracing back everything to Krishna.
Whatever you eat.
Which I just did, no, we ate the pen. Whatever object you subjectify, that is Krishna Arpanam, that is real Krishna Arpanamastu. When I say subjectify, real subject. Like how in the dream you say, everything is me, everything is Krishna. So, Shishadiji, what is the outcome of this is, at any point in time, there is a thought, inquire for whom is the thought, and from where this thought is arising. And in this inquiry, the thought will disappear. The thought will not arise. The mind will shut down. Eventually, because of this line of questioning, the mind will die. It's called the death of the mind. The body dies many times. The mind dies only once. And the death of the mind is called enlightenment. And in the death of the mind, it stops creating stories. Okay, and then you are, will remain as Sakshi. Everything that happens, you will experience as if it's a dream. You will not associate reality to objects. You will not associate reality to experiences. You will know it's a dream or it's a dream. The only reality will be associated to is you. And when I say you, is Sakshi. So you will not have any fear of life, death, anything. Fear will disappear from your consciousness. Okay. Any more doubts? Shishadiji, does that clarify the question that you had?
Yes.
So for whom it clarifies? That yes, also is a I know, I understood. The one who says I understood is a thought that appeared. But you are already, Sakshi is living in that experience of understanding. You are, that is your reality. You don't have to understand it. The one who says I understood is the I thought. There'll come a point when you go beyond I understood also. There's no meaning for I understood. Because there will be no more understanding, there will be no more use for the instrument called mind. When you realize that mind cannot know, cannot understand. Can mind understand anything? I told you, thought cannot know, mind cannot understand, computer cannot understand. The one understanding belongs to chit, consciousness. And for chit, there's nothing to understand.
Just witnessing.
Just witnessing. I understood, I don't understand. All that doesn't make any sense. So the only thing that you can say is nothing. There is nothing you can speak. The moment you open your mouth and say, this is it, it is not it. Nothing can be told about enlightenment. Nothing can be told about Sakshi. You can be it. You can't say it. You can't see it. You can't explain it. But if you don't explain it, also there's the problem. Okay, any more questions?
It was a fantastic session, Guruji.
See, nothing is there. Nothing has happened. There is no creation. There are no objects. There are no people. But everything appears. And everything appears is fine. Like in a virtual, when you put a virtual headgear, everything appears. Appearancing is not the problem. The notion when you put on the VR set, you have a notion that is not real. But here you don't have, you have a notion that is real. That's the only problem. You understand? Perception is not the problem. Interpretation that it's reality is a problem. When you put on a headgear also, there's a perception. Okay, I see, I'm going to roller coaster and all that. Perception is never the problem. The notion that the perception is reality is a problem. And it's actually not a problem. That is not a problem for Sakshi. There is no problem at all. But you say you have a problem, then there is a solution that is given. Vivek, the logic clear? I thought. The thought itself, only one thought at a time. Thought itself is insentient. And the thought appears from consciousness. All objects are nothing but thought. Thought is consciousness. The problem is, the thought which is an object, you made it into a subject. Why you made it into a subject? Because you don't know the real object. It's a real subject. When you know the real subject, you will see thought as a thought, emotion as an object, thought as an object, world as an object, everything is an object. You as an object, ego. And I say you, the personality, Vivek, as an object. So whatever is happening to Vivek, you will see it as happening to somebody else. Like now how we see something happening to me, like some other person. Like that you will be able to see things happening to Vivek. Right now you have become Vivek. So this is this shloka. I only covered Ayamatma Brahma. Sarvam Etat Brahma, I covered a little bit in terms of how object is thought and all that. There is more elaboration about how world is also Brahman. We'll come to that in the next few sessions. And like I said, in the next few sessions, the four quadrants are addressed: waking, dreaming, deep sleep, and then Turiya, and then Phalashruti. This is the journey of the Mandukya. Phalashruti, the phala, the result of understanding Mandukya.
Guruji, can you please share the last class Phalashruti and the Shanti Mantra that you recited in the group, please?
Yeah, it's part of that video, the previous video. Which,
yeah, no, I know. But you told, right? Can you type it and send or something like that? Or if you have it?
The shloka, I'll send that. Yeah, Shanti Mantra, Bhadram Karani. Mm.
Thank you.
I am Atma. Now, who can say I am Atma Brahma? Can you say I am Atma Brahma? And Brahma, when I say Brahma, don't think Brahma is something. I is Brahman, the real I. All you see, I am real I. I am not false. I am not ego. That's all. Which is a reality. But don't go and tell this to other people. That's all. Don't go into tomorrow office and say, I am Atma Brahma. You work for me. Don't do that. Whatever is said in the session is only for you. Please, please do not go and tell it outside. Only if you have made up of steel, you can do that, because you'll be crucified. People who told that, I am son of God. He didn't even say, I am Atma Brahma. He told, I am son of Brahma. I am son of God. Got crucified. So depending on the which part of the world you're in, you'll get different kinds of punishments. It's okay. If you're in India and if you say I am Atma Brahma, they'll say okay. Some in some places they'll throw stones at you. Some people will fall at your feet. But don't ever go and say I am Atma Brahma outside, okay? In this class, you can say I am Atma Brahma. But outside, just know I am Atma Brahma. Any doubt? Shall we close?
Yes.
Tvameva Mata.
Tvameva Mata.
Pita Tvameva.
Pita Tvameva.
Tvameva Bandhuscha.
Tvameva Bandhuscha.
Tvameva.
Sakha Tvameva.
Tvameva Vidya.
Tvameva Vidya.
Dravinam Tvameva.
Dravinam Tvameva.
Tvameva Sarvam.
Tvameva Sarvam.
Mama Deva Deva.
Mama Deva Deva.
Loka Samasta.
Loka Samasta.
Sukhino Bhavantu.
Sukhino Bhavantu.
Loka Samasta.
Loka Samasta.
Sukhino Bhavantu.
Sukhino Bhavantu.
Hari Om.
Hari Om.
Shri Gurubhyo Namaha.
Shri Gurubhyo Namaha.
Hari Om.
Hari Om.
Hari Om. See you all in the next session. Have it next month. We share the details of the next session in the group.
Thank you, Krishna. Thank
many
you,
thanks.
Thank you, Guruji.
Many thanks.
Thank you. Bye.